the angel of the Lord brought tidings to Mary, and she conceived by the Holy Ghost. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and in the hour of our death. Amen. Behold the handmaid of the Lord. Be it done unto me according to thy word. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and in the hour of our death. Amen. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and in the hour of our death. Amen. Pray for us, O Holy Mother of God, that we may be made worthy of the promises of Christ. Let us pray. Pour forth, we beseech thee, O Lord, thy grace into our hearts, as we have known the incarnation of thy Son, Jesus Christ, by the message of an angel, so by his cross and passion that we come to know the glory of his resurrection, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti. Amen. In tuo laboratare Dei, ed in glitificare iugum tutum meum, iurica me destra giuscere casa meum de gente non sancta, ab nomen in ene codo losso error me. Cui tu esterus fortitudum, quare repulistit, quare crisis in cielo, dum uffligi me, nemicus. Ebite lucem tuum veritatem tuum, visum et ebus erum, tu lux erum, timontum sanctum tuum, et ab natura tua. Et in tuo laboratare Dei, ed in glitificare iugum tutum meum, confite cutibi in citra, Deus, Deus meus, patricis anima mea, ne quale cum tubas me. Sper in Deo, quale me tro confite cuini, salutari vultus me, Deus meus. Gloria, Patri, Filio, et Spiritui Sancto, sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. In tua laboratari Dei, et in glitifica in juventutum meum, auditorium nostrum in nomine Domini, qui feci caelum et terra. Confite, O Domine potenti, Beata Maria, Servigio, Beato Michele Tangio, Beato Gian Battista, Santi Spostis Petro e Paolo, Beato Pane Maria, Piano, Nomus Santi Bobis Fatres, Cui Begavi in miscogitazione, Bebo ad opere, meo culpa, mea maxima culpa. Ed eo prego, Beata Maria, Sempre Vigine, Beato Michele Macangio, Beato Juan Battista, Santo Spostis Petro e Paolo, Beato Juan Maria, Piano, Nomus Santi Bobis Fatres, Ora ripone, Domino Deo Nostro. Miseria tutui in potenze, sed misis peccatis tuis, peducate vita metana. Amen.
Confite, O Deo omnipotenti, beate Maria sempre virgini, beate Michaeli arcangelo, beate Ioani Battiste, sanctis apostolis Petro et Paolo, omnibus sanctis et fidi pater, qui erat avenimis cogitatione, verbo et opere, mea culpa, mea maxima culpa. Ed io prego, beata Mariam sempre virgen, beata Michaelem arcangelum, beata Juan Battista, sanctus apostolos Petrum et Paulum, omnes sanctos et te pater, ora pro me, ad dominum Deo nostrum. Miseriatu vestri impotens Deus, id mis peccati vestri petruca vostra vita metana.
Amen.
Indulgentiam
associarum permissionem peccatorum nostrorum tribuo ad nobis omnipotens et misericus Dominus.
Amen.
Deus tu conversus specificabis nos,
et plus tu et abitur in te.
Ostendi nobis Domini misericordiam tua,
et salutare tua et nobis.
Domine exaudi rationem mea,
et clama meus ad te venio.
Dominus vobiscum,
et cum spiritu tuo.
Orde. Loque valo dei testimoni istuis in conspectu regum, et non confundeva, et meritava rimandatis tuis, quae dilixte in nemis. Volumes confiteri Domino, et celeri nomine tuo altissime. Gloria Patri, Filio, et Spiritui Sancto, sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. Loque valo dei testimoni istuis in conspectu regum, et non confundeva, et meritava rimandatis tuis, quae dilixte in nemis. Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Christe eleison,
Christe eleison,
Christe eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie eleison,
Kyrie eleison. Gloria in excelsis Deo, et in terra pax omnibus boni voluntatis, laudamus te, benedicimus te, adoramus te, glorificamus te. Gratis agimus tibi propter magnam gloriam tuam. Domine Deus, Rex Celestis, Deus Patrum Omnipotens, Domine Filii Unigenite, Iesu Christe, Domine Deus, Agnus Dei, Filius Patris, qui tollis peccatum mundi, miserere nobis, qui tollis peccatum mundi, suscipe deprecationem nostram, qui sedis ad extram Patris, miserere nobis. Gloriam tu solus sanctus, tu solus dominus, tu solus altissimus, Iesu Christe, cum sanctu spiritu in gloria Dei Patris. Amen. Ex vobis,
et cum spiritu tuo,
ordinus. Sancti Giovannis Baptiste, precursoris martiris tui, quaesmus Domine, venerante festivitas, salutaris auxili nobis prestati fecum, qui vivis et regnes cum Deo Patri in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Amen. Ordinus. Deus, qui intergetera potentiae tuae miracula etiam in saeculo fragili victoria martiri conquisti, concede propitius, utque beati Sabine martiris tui natalitiae corimus per eius et te exemple gradiamur. Per Dominum nostrum Iesu Christum Filium Tuum, qui tecum vivit et regnat ad unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum. Amen. Lectio Ieremiae Prophetae, in diebus illis factum est verbum Domini et mei dicens, accede lungus tuus et surge, et locuere ad iudaeo omnia, quae ego principio tibi. Ne formidae esse face eorum, ne genitim meriete face votum deorum. Ego qui vedete hodi in civitatem unitam, et in columnam ferriam, et in murum aerium, super omnem terram, regibus iuda, principibus eius et sacerdotibus et populo terrae, et barabunt adversum te, et non prevelebunt, quia ego tecum sum me dominus, ut liberem te.
Deo gratias.
Iustus ut palm flore ibici, cogetus libani multiplicabitur in domo Domini, annunciantum ad misericordiam tuam et veritatem tuam per noctem. Alleluia, alleluia. Iustus geminabit sic ut lilium et florebit in aeternum ante Dominum. Alleluia. Dominus obiscum,
et cum spiritu tuo,
sequentia sancti evangelii secundum Marcum,
gloria tibi Domine.
In vino tempore, misi Herodes Antenue Ioannem, et vincit eum in carcere prote Herodiadum uxorem Philippi fratris sui, quid uxerat eam. Diceva tenum Ioannes Herodi, non licetibi haberi uxorum fratris tui. Herodias autem insidiaba aturili, et volebat occideri eum, ne poterat. Herodes enim metuebat Ioannem, sciens eum verum justum et sanctum, et fustuteabat eum, et auditu eum multa faciebat, et libenter eum audiebat. Et cum dies opportuni sacidissit, Herodes natalis sui cenum feci principibus et tribunis et primus Galilae, cumque introissit filia ipsius Herodiadis, et saltasit et placuissit Herodis simunque recompensibus. Ex et puele, peti a me quod vis et abu tibi. Et un avit ili, qui ad quicuit peti eris abu tibi, licit imitium regni mei. Quae cum insistissit, dixit matri sue, quid petam? Et ile dixit, caput Iovannis Baptiste. Cumque introvisit statum confessionatione ad regum, pedivit dicens, voluut protinus des mici in disco caput Iovannis Baptiste, et contristatus ex rex, prote ius jurandum et prote simon descompensis noli viteam contristare, sed mi suspicutatore precepit aferi caput eius in disco, et decola vit eum in carcere, et aturit caput eius in disco, et dedit illud puele, puera et egit matri sue. Quo audito discipuli eus venerunt et tulerunt corpus eus, et possiverunt illo di monumento.
Laus tibi Christi.
This, the feast of the decollation or beheading of St. John the Baptist, the lesson is taken from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. At this time the Lord's words came to me, gird up thy loins, bestir thyself, and deliver to Judah all the charge I am giving thee. Do not be afraid of them, as thou wouldst not have me shame thee before them. I mean to give thee strength this day, strength as of a fortified city, or iron pillar, or brazen wall, to confront the whole land, princes of Judah and priests and people. All will be thy adversaries, but they shall not master thee. I will be at thy side, the Lord says, to bring thee deliverance. And the Holy Gospel today is a continuation of that according to St. Mark. At this time, Herod had sent and arrested John and put him in prison, in chains, for love of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, whom he had married, because John had told Herod, it is wrong for thee to take thy brother's wife. Herodias was always plotting against him and would willingly have murdered him, but could not, because Herod was afraid of John, recognizing him for an upright and holy man, so that he kept him carefully and followed his advice in many things and was glad to listen to him. And now came a fitting occasion upon which Herod gave a birthday feast to his lords and officers and to the chief men of Galilee. Herodias' own daughter came in and danced, and gave such pleasure to Herod and his guests that the king said to the girl, ask me for whatever thou wilt, and thou shalt have it. He even bound himself by an oath, I will grant whatever request thou makest, though it were half of my kingdom. Thereupon she went out and said to her mother, what shall I ask for? And she answered, the head of John the Baptist. With that she hastened into the king's presence and made her request. My will is, she said, that thou shouldest give me the head of John the Baptist. Give it me now on a dish. And the king was full of remorse, but out of respect to his oath and to those who sat with him at table, he would not disappoint her. So he sent one of his guard with orders that the head should be brought on a dish. This soldier cut off his head in the prison and brought it on a dish and gave it to the girl, and the girl gave it to her mother. When John's disciples heard of it, they came and carried off his body and laid it in a tomb. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and in the hour of our death. Amen. Omnipotens et Filii Spiritus Sancti. Amen. Carissimi, beloved in Christ, welcome to this broadcast Mass on this, as we said, the feast of the decollation or beheading of St. John the Baptist. We also commemorate today St. Sabina, martyred widow, who was martyred during the 2nd century under the Emperor Hadrian, martyred with Seraphia, her handmaid, who had taught her the faith and brought her to faith. The Gospel narrative today explains to us clearly why we are celebrating this feast. The Old Testament reading today speaks to, of course, figuratively, St. John the Baptist himself. No one, I think, could deny that St. John the Baptist had great courage, was full of confidence, had that strength as such was given to Jeremiah the prophet, even though the king and the priests and the people were his adversaries. This did not prevent, or rather, because of his strength and because of his confidence, because we might say he was full of God's grace, he was not afraid to speak the truth to King Herod. He pointed out to Herod that he should not have married his brother's wife. For this, of course, his life was in danger. For this, he was imprisoned by Herod.
But it's interesting to note that although Herodias desired the death of John the Baptist, because of course she recognized the sin for which she was being called out by him, she of course did not like to be reminded of her sin, so she would have had him murdered on the spot. But notice that Herod had respect for John the Baptist, admired him even, was inspired by him, sought his counsel and his advice, because Herod recognized in John a man of God. We might say that Herod, for all his faults, yet even there was still within him a part of him that wanted to please God, wanted to hear God's word. But perhaps feeling constrained by his own actions, was unable to do the right thing, was unable to prefer God over his own situation of his own making. So when the daughter of Herodias dances well, and Herod offers her this gift, ask anything of you like, even if it were half of my kingdom, and makes an oath. Now, of course, we might say, well, that oath is as naught if it was for something wrong. But Herod, because of his pride, did not want to lose face in front of his generals, in front of his courtiers. So it is that when she asks for the head of John on a dish, he feels honor bound, he feels duty bound to grant her request, despite the anguish that it causes him. There are many, many, many people, my brothers and sisters, who are like Herod. Indeed, there are many who are like Herodias and Herod. Who know that their situation is wrong. Who know that the manner of their life, who know that the things they do and have done are wrong. But we do have, my brothers and sisters, an innate sense of right and wrong. There are many, of course, who will tell us that nature and nurture has such an effect that it is society that dictates to us what is right and wrong. That it is society's influence upon the environment of our nurture, of our social conditioning, that dictates what is right and wrong, or informs our conscience of what is right and wrong. But we all know, my brothers and sisters, the truth that we all have an innate sense of what is right or wrong. Irrespective of social mores or social norms or the law of the society in which we live. We have an innate sense of what is right and wrong. This Holy Mother Church, of course, refers to as the natural law, because we naturally intuit it. We see this manifest in little children, not so much in babies, but in toddlers particularly. How many times have you seen a little toddler steal, grab a toy from another toddler and look around or look up because they know they've done wrong. They know innately they've done wrong. They didn't ask the other little fella if they could share. They didn't ask the little fella if he had finished with it and could they have it. They just took it. Quite often, even mischievously, quite often, even deliberately, they know what they're doing. So we have an innate sense of what is right and wrong. We have an innate sense of the natural law, of God's natural law. We have an innate sense of morality. And often, my brothers and sisters, despite those who call out sins and transgressions, the truth is we judge and condemn ourselves. Herod and Herodias didn't need John to point out their sin, to point out their fault. They were already aware of it. They already knew it was wrong. The law and the prophets, already long extant by this time, said that they were wrong. But Herod, in his arrogance as king, thought himself above God's law, or at least above the law. Thus Herod and Herodias, knowing already that they were in sin, disliked being reminded, disliked being told. Many of us, my brothers and sisters, react in the same way when our sin or fault is pointed out. Indeed, some are so sensitive because they are so aware that what they are doing is wrong, they are so sensitive that even if that sin is called out, but not specifically in relation to them, but is called out in a general way, they respond viciously against it. The truth is, it's because they have condemned themselves. It's because they know that what they are doing is wrong, that they are so sensitive to that sin being named, to that sin being discussed, to that sin being talked about, let alone them being accused truthfully of it. We see this in the way that public debate is conducted these days. We see it in the way people respond to things on Facebook and social media. Straightway the retort is, who are you to judge me? Why are you judging me? The truth is, they've already judged themselves. They've already condemned themselves. They already know that what they are doing is wrong. I don't know, some of you may have seen a short video I published last week talking about the sacrament of confession, but making the point that, contrary to popular belief, particularly by those outside the church, who think that the sacrament of confession is all about the priest judging, it is the other way around. And noticeably, this is a sacrament that is initiated by the penitent. The sacrament begins with the words, "Bless me, Father, for I have sinned." It is initiated by the penitent. And it is the penitent who brings themselves to confession because they are accusing themselves. When they say, "Bless me, Father, for I have sinned," the priest does not then turn round and say, "Yes, indeed you have, because you have done A, B, C, D, E, F, G." He doesn't do that because he can't, because he doesn't know. Even if he knows the penitent well, even though he might have suspicions as to what kind of thing somebody might be confessing, he does not know what the penitent is going to confess. There are three exceptions to that in history. Jesus, he always knew the sins and the secrets of men's hearts. And other than Jesus, Saint Jean Vianney, the curé de Arles, and Saint Padre Pio of Pietrelcina. Those two particular confessors are infamous because they have been imbued with such grace by God that in the confessional they could tell the penitent what they had come to confess. And when it got to that, what some people think is a all-out, get-out caveat for all these sins, which I cannot now remember, Saint Jean Vianney and Padre Pio would remind you. They would tell you those things you're pretending you can't remember. They were particularly blessed by God to see into men's hearts. But that is very rare. Two exceptions in history aside from Jesus Christ. I haven't that ability. God hasn't blessed me with that gift, you might be relieved to know. But it is the penitent who, having condemned themselves in their own interior reflection, who having at home thought to themselves, "Oh, I shouldn't have done that. I know that's a sin. I know that's wrong," have brought themselves to the sacrament of confession and initiate the sacrament themselves. "Bless me, Father, for I have sinned." And then they accuse themselves of their sins. Now, it is true that the priest uses judgment in the sense that he uses prudence to counsel the penitent. The priest will tell you if what you think is a sin is not a sin, and he will confirm for you that what you think is a sin is indeed a sin. But he will not judge you. He will not judge you and he will not condemn you. His sole purpose in the confessional is to hear your contrition, hear your sorrow, witness your humility before God, and then soothe and comfort and console you with God's words of absolution. So Herod and Herodias knew they were in the wrong and did not like having it called out. But what's even worse, perhaps, is this oath that Herod felt he could not break to Herodias' daughter. Now we would say, and a canon lawyer or a moral theologian would say, would have advised Herod and said, "You cannot be bound by that oath." was a reckless promise that you couldn't possibly have meant. And Herod would have replied, ah, but it was witnessed by important people, by my courtiers, by my generals, perhaps by the local Roman officials. I would lose face if I did not honour it. And here again, my brothers and sisters, many, many, many people can relate to that situation. They feel bound, constrained, entrapped even by particular circumstances and situations and scenarios of sin that prevents them, they think, from doing the right thing. They fear the consequences. They fear losing face. They don't want to be ashamed. They don't want to be humiliated. They don't want to be mocked. And this, my brothers and sisters, is always the same, irrespective of whatever the sin is. God's eyes, sin is sin. But all sin has the potential to be forgiven. Humble and contrite heart the Lord will not despise. Ask, and it will be given to you. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, not to condemn the world, but to love. There is no sin that cannot be forgiven, except one. Blaspheme against the Holy Spirit, which means to believe that a sin can't be forgiven. That is what will condemn an individual. That's when a soul might come before God at the throne of grace at the end of time. And their sins will be read out to them that have not been absolved. And when they are accused of having blasphemed against the Holy Ghost because they did not and refused to believe that they could have been absolved, they will go to the other place. Forthwith, there and then. Because that is the ultimate denial of God. To refuse belief in God's grace, to refuse belief in God's tender and loving mercy, even though he has provided every opportunity for us to avail ourselves of it. That is the unforgivable sin. My brothers and sisters, we should not want to be like Herod, entrapping ourselves. lives within our own ever-decreasing circle or cyclone of sins, imprisoning ourselves, enslaving ourselves, when we know the way out. And though it may involve some humiliation, though it will involve humbling ourselves before God, if we are truly contrite, if we are truly sorry, we have only to trust in God's word. And avail ourselves of the opportunity to receive his love and mercy. The chances are, we do not know, but the chances are that Herod, bless him, never confessed, never sought nor received the fullness of his redemption. He lived when the Word dwelt among us. He even met Jesus Christ when Pontius Pilate sent Christ to him for trial. He had the opportunity then to know God's love and mercy. But if his pride had entrapped him at this stage, it had certainly become solid by the time Jesus stood before him. And as we reflected before, my brothers and sisters, every sin that we commit is another brick in the wall. Every mortal sin, which is a sin against God's declared law, so a sin against the Decalogue, one of the Ten Commandments, that is a boulder, that is a rock, a brick. And all the venial sins, all the little white lies and things like that, that is the mortar. And it is we who build the wall. It is we who build the barrier. Every time we transgress God's law of love, of charity, we ourselves build this barrier of sin, separating ourselves from God. And that is what you hear. That is what you hear from those who rail against the church, who rail against the teachings of the gospel. There is fear and anger. It is they building this wall, separating themselves off from God's love and mercy. And even when sometimes we don't feel we have the strength within us to break that wall down, then must we trust evermore in him. Then must we put our faith in him. Then is the moment we should believe. Because not to believe that we can be forgiven will consign us to the great fiery lake, to be forever consumed in pain and suffering by the love of God, because we refused it, because we denied it, because we would not bring ourselves to accept it. Now we are called, my brothers and sisters, as we've reflected many times before, to be like John the Baptist, to be heralds in our own time for our own generation, heralds of the second coming, heralds like St. John the Baptist crying in the wilderness, "Prepare ye the way of the Lord, repent and believe." This is all part of the divine commission to preach the gospel and bring others to salvation through baptism. But we have to be careful, my brothers and sisters, with this great charge. There are some who relish in thinking of themselves as contemporary John the Baptists. Who call out other people's sins, who accuse others mercilessly, ruthlessly. But there's a big difference between them and St. John the Baptist. For there was no sin in John the Baptist. Like the Virgin Mary, the Church has believed that St. John was preserved from sin by God's grace because of the great vocation, because of the great role he played in our salvation. Remember how he leapt in his mother's womb at the voice of the Mother of God. Nobody else, my brothers and sisters, has that ability or that right like he had to call out other people's sins, to condemn other people for their sins. Our Lord told us, "Do not judge others, for you will be judged as you judge them." We are not, my brothers and sisters, imbued with divine righteousness. We do not have the ability to read and see into other people's hearts and minds. So we have to be careful in our charge of being heralds in our own time. Yes, we are to present the gospel. Yes, we must be clear about what the gospel message is. But we should, as St. Paul commends to Timothy, rebuke with all the patience of a teacher. We should be able to explain why some things are wrong. We should be able to explain because of the truth of the gospel. But we should be gentle. We should be humble in recognition of our own faults and weaknesses and fragility. There may be times when it is necessary to make a stand for the truth against sin. But the majority of the time, it's only necessary for us to teach others by example, to proclaim the gospel by example, by faith and works, demonstrating in our lives, in the way in which we live our lives, God's love and mercy. Sisters. so strive. Remember ourselves to avail ourselves as often as it may be necessary of God's love and tender mercy and his grace through the sacrament of reconciliation. Let us encourage and guide others similarly to recognize their waywardness, to recognize their faults, and tell them that despite the barrier that they have put up, it can be taken.